Have you ever heard of a visual IDE? How about one built specifically for React? What if I told you that there is a tool that can help you build and edit React components visually along with your project's code base? As you build your components, almost like you're in Figma or Illustrator, the React code along with all of the CSS styles are written for you. Sounds like magic, right? Let's take this thing for a spin and see what it can do. Let me introduce you to Codux, the sponsor of today's video. Codux is a visual IDE or graphical editor, and it allows you to build and edit React components like you're drawing on a canvas. You'll see and have access to the code right inside of Codux, but it shouldn't replace your existing IDE. In fact, the goal of Codux is not to replace your existing IDE, but to turbocharge your React workflow by giving you the ability to visually edit as well. As you make changes in Codux, you'll see the updates happen in real time in your existing IDE. Codux supports almost any React project built using TypeScript and styling in CSS, Sass, or CSS modules, and it has full Git integration. Another great feature is the ability to develop components in isolation. That's generally how we build in React. We build components, but we usually can't see each component rendered in isolation. With Codux, you can work on each component individually, see each component in various states, and then bring them all together where they're needed. So the idea is to build out your component library here in Codux. Because this is a graphical user interface, even someone with little to no React experience can easily update and edit components visually and be confident that the updates reflected in the code will be accurate. So maybe your designer is familiar with an application like Figma. You could collaborate with your designer in real time, let them make some tweaks visually while you work on the functionality of the site. And just like in your browser's DevTools, you'll see all of the CSS styles for each element, the computed styles, and you can edit all of them. This makes memorizing every CSS property name and value a thing of the past. Every property is visually available to edit, and these changes take place immediately in your code base. To get started, you can either import almost any existing React project or create a new project from scratch. And that's what we're going to do. To show you what Codux is capable of, I'm going to build a YouTube clone from scratch. First, go to the Codux website and then download Codux for your operating system. It's currently in public beta and is completely free. There's a link in the description below. Once you have it installed, this is what you'll see. So we're going to start by creating a new project. I'll name mine YouTube clone and we'll use the default CSS styling. Next, it's going to prompt us to install our dependencies. This is basically like npm install. And now we can see our React app here in our first board. Think of boards as components. The app itself is a component, but then we can have other components, which can all be integrated in different ways. On the elements pane, it's kind of like a file explorer, but for elements. We have them in their hierarchy. We can expand each one and see what's inside them. We can even open this in a new browser window. If we go back to Codux, if we adjust the viewport and then we go back to our browser, we can see that reflects in our component in the browser as well. We can also run all of our scripts here from within Codux. So we have our start script. We can go ahead and run that. And it's going to start up a development server just like it normally would and open up in our browser. And there's the actual application running in our browser. And we can see our console messages here as well. If we go to the files pane, we can see all of the normal files that we would see in our project in our regular IDE. So if we look at our package.json, we can see all the packages required for this project. And again, projects in Codux use TypeScript. It also has Git integration, so if we go to the Git panel, we can see that there are changes that need to be committed. And then back in the elements panel, we can click on any element and view the code specifically for that element. It will take us directly to that in the built-in code editor. And if you're familiar with VS Code, this code editor will be very familiar to you. If we click on an element, on the right side, we have our properties panel. We can see all of the properties for that element. The ones that are checked off are the ones that are being used currently. And if we scroll down, we can see every possible property of this element that we could use. And then we can see the computed styles. And then we have our styles panel. This is where we can add classes to our selectors and make all of our changes to our CSS styles here in this GUI editor. So if we click on the class that is applied to this element, we can see every possible property and value, and we can visually change these and see the effect in real time. And if we wanted to see the code for this class, we can go up to the class, click the three dots, and view code. And it takes us to our style sheet, specifically for this class. Now back in our elements panel, we can actually just click on these elements and drag and drop to rearrange them. And it rearranges them in our code for us. So we could completely reverse these with just a couple of clicks. And again, there is full Git integration. We can see that we have some commits that we need to make. We can also create new branches, create pull requests, everything right here from within Codux. Now, if we swap over to our normal IDE, I use Visual Studio Code for everything. We can see the same information here, 3 pending changes to commit. And we have all of our files available to us. We can open up our app.tsx file. We can see that the changes we made reorganizing our elements in Codux have been reflected here in our IDE as well. So if we go back into Codux and we rearrange them again, let's put the image back on top and then go directly back into VS Code. We can see the image is back on top in our code in VS Code as well. So that's super cool. Let's take a look at the final product that we're going to build. We want to create a clone of YouTube. So we're going to break this up into components. We're going to create a header, a sidebar, the video preview, a grid, and then put all of these components together. So to start out, let's delete all of the existing elements in here to clear the stage for our new components. And we'll start out by building the header. So in the elements panel, we can go to add, and then we have all of these elements that we can choose from. So let's add a header element. We need our menu items, so let's add a span for that, and then we'll put an SVG inside there. So for the SVG, I'll just go into the code and paste in the SVG that I copied from the YouTube website. And we need to define a class for the header. We'll make it flex, set a height, and some padding. And we'll add a class to the SVG as well, add some padding around that. We'll add another span for the logo, and then we'll create our search box. So we'll add an input there and a button. And then it looks like we've got a couple more buttons to the side that we need to add. I can easily add classes to these, go to the styles panel, and then modify all the styles as needed. And we'll work on the search button. And then it looks like there's a speech or a microphone button. So we could make a reusable class for different things like buttons. So we'll add that reusable class to these buttons, but it looks like these don't have a background color. So we'll add another class to take that background color off, and then the avatar for the user. All right, we'll add some final padding around the edges of the header, and then we'll make sure that it's responsive and it looks good at any width. And next, let's create the sidebar. So for that, we're going to create a new component. We'll name it sidebar. And under advanced, you'll see the relative path where it's going to create the component for us, as well as the path for the board that it creates. But I'm just gonna leave that at default and create that. Then let's edit the sidebar. Let's define the wrapping structure first. We've got a bunch of buttons to add. So I'll just drag in a bunch of buttons from the add menu. And let's go ahead and enter the text for each of these buttons. And then let's define a basic class that we can apply to each one of these. Each one of them also has an SVG. So I'm gonna move over into VS Code and just copy and paste these SVGs in. And then I'm gonna define the SVG width in our sidebar module SCSS. Let's add the background and foreground colors. And then we'll apply the same class to each of these buttons and paste in their SVGs. And then some other minor tweaks just to get everything aligned and spaced out correctly. And there we have our sidebar. All right, next we have this filters bar, which shows a bunch of topics that we can filter by. Let's create that component next. So we'll add another new component. We'll name that filters. And for this component, I want to show you a really cool feature of Codux. Instead of dragging and dropping a ton of buttons in here, since we're not really sure how many buttons there's going to be every single time, we're going to build this by writing the code and seeing how Codux interprets our coded components. So I'm going to open up the filters.tsx file that Codux just created in my project. And then I'll add some dummy data in a variable called button labels. And then in the JSX, I'll map over the button labels and then return a button element for each one. Now all I have to do is save this and switch back to Codux. And I didn't have to do anything inside of Codux. It just automatically picked up the new components and has categorized them as a repeater. So now I just need to style these components. I'll change the background color, add some spacing, padding, margin, and create a button class that can be applied to each button. I'll also make sure that it's responsive. The component should overflow off the edge and the overflow should be hidden. And then lastly, I'll create an active class for that first button. And there we go. Now we have our filters component. Next, we'll create our video preview. Each one of these videos will have an image and a title and some other information. So let's create that, and then we can duplicate that as many times as we need in our app. So we'll create a new component. I'll name it video preview. Let's create the structure. We'll add an image. So in our image properties, we can see here our source. By default, it is an image being pulled from Wix. So we'll change out the source string to one of the thumbnail images. Then we'll apply a class to the image. We'll set our width and round the corners. Then we'll add our channel avatar, which is going to be another image below there. And we'll add the source string for the avatar. Then let's add our title. Let's add the rest of the information, the channel name, the views, and the date published. All right, so now we need to edit that image and round off the corners, make it a circle. We'll set our background color and then just do some more alignment on the text. And then we're going to add an SVG for the verified checkmark, and we need to resize that. So I'll go into the SCSS and we'll just set a width on that SVG. And then let's add some more padding, adjust these corners on the image and make sure that it's responsive. All right, now what we can do is define props for our image component. So the component itself needs to accept a thumbnail string. It needs a title string, all of the other information as strings. We'll make sure that the verified is a Boolean and it's not required. So if it is present, the SVG will appear. And if it's not, then it won't. So because this is TypeScript, we're going to go into our code and edit our interface to add those variables and then pass those variables into our component. Then we'll change out these hard-coded strings to our props. Technically, once I've added these variables to our interface, we could enter those in the UI, but I'm already here in the code, so we'll just add those right here into our code. So now we can go into our board and edit the information that is passed into our board. So we'll add in those same hard-coded strings into our board just so that we have a preview in Codux. So we'll add our thumbnail string, our avatar string, and so on right here. All right, so now in Codux, we have our video preview completed, and I think the next step is to put it all together. All right, let's go up into our app now. And actually, I kind of messed up at the beginning because I used the app container to create our header. So let's go ahead and just copy all of the header information out of the app container. And let's make a new container for the header. So I'm going to rename this back to app, create a new container called header, and then paste that code back into here. And now we should have our header component separate from our app component. All right, now that we have that cleaned out of our app component, we can go into the Add Elements panel, and then under Local Components, we'll see all of the local components that we've created. Our header, our sidebar, our video preview, filters, and we can now add those into our app component. So we'll just drag the header over. We'll start with that one. And then we'll add a div container so that we can separate the header from the sidebar, the filter, and the main body. We'll add in our filter component, make some minor adjustments, make sure that the overflow on the filter component is hidden, and then we'll add another div and make this a grid. Now within the grid, we can add all of our video preview components. So we'll have two rows with four on each row. Now each of these components needs some props. So let's go ahead and copy and paste our props for our thumbnail image and our avatar and so on into each of these. And then we'll work on the padding and the spacing of these. And now we can update each one of these video components with custom data. And we can do that right inside Codux in the UI, since we have access to the interface properties that we added. We can open that in a new browser window, take a look at it. Looks good. Now back in Codux, if we go to our scripts panel, we can go ahead and start the application and make sure it all looks good locally. So we'll start the start script, and that's going to open up in our browser, and that's looking good. Now one last thing to polish up this YouTube clone application, we need a new name for this YouTube clone. So instead of that YouTube premium logo, since we created this using Codux, let's change this to DuckTube. That looks much better. So now let's commit all of our changes and sync everything with GitHub. So we'll go to commit, we'll add a commit message and go ahead and save those. Then let's publish our project. We'll click the sync button and continue. So this is going to create a GitHub repo, and I'll go ahead and make that public, and we'll create this. And we go to GitHub and we can see that right there. It's been synced and we have a new project now on GitHub. And if we go over to the source control panel in Codux, we can see the commit history and no current changes. I think Codux is a game changer for React developers. You should definitely give it a try today. It's currently in public beta and is completely free. Use the link in the description below. If this video has helped you out, give it a like and subscribe for more content like this.